You know his words will get you farther than the film will ever go. Give him a moment of your time, he'll tell you what's wrong with the show. He knows what's good, what's bad, what's really bad. His face is just a sign. Say hello to Confused Matthew.
Titanic may have been the first movie that I talked about as Confused Matthew. I gave a basic outline of what I didn't like about it, but this was at a time when I hadn't decided to do full in-depth reviews. Hell, I hadn't even decided whether or not I wanted to do reviews at all. The resources I had available to me at the time were also limited. I couldn't even run videos on my computer, and so just as with a lot of my earlier reviews, I was forced to resort to stills. And at the time, I was also limited by YouTube's 10-minute time frame. Long story short, I have wanted to talk more deeply about why I didn't like this film for years, but I just didn't have the means to do it the way I felt I needed to. All of that has changed now, however. I think the equipment I'm using is still at least 3 years behind the times, but the video works more or less, and I have become somewhat more comfortable in front of the mic, so I now have the opportunity to finally do this. And man, what a this. I have poo-pooed some pretty big films in my time, but this might just be the biggest one. I've been reviewing a lot of softballs recently, and I'm now tackling possibly the world's biggest movie. This puts me right back where I started, and possibly right back where I belong. Alone on the stage, saying my piece, dodging the tomatoes as they fly my way. I never liked this movie, and I had a lot of high hopes for it, too. I went into the theater preparing myself for a real tearjerker. All I got out of it was a lot of sighing and eye-rolling. What is so special about this movie? It's not even about the Titanic, and what it is about has been done so many times by so many different storytellers that before we even enter the theater, we've seen this movie already. And even that wouldn't have been so bad for me. I mean, we've got a story here where the two people from two different worlds fall in love, and every circumstance is working against their union. I love that story. I live for this shit. The problem that plagues it, however, is just plain lazy writing. It would have all been fine if James Cameron had added one single new idea, angle, or even perspective on this old formula. But he doesn't. He just dresses it up in the background of the Titanic setting. There are a million love stories that are more interesting than this. I've had love stories more interesting than this. And with the exception of the ship sinking, this movie has nothing to do with and doesn't even have anything in common with the real story of the Titanic, other than the fact that it sunk. But this brings me to why I wanted to review this movie in full, and it's not just to complain about it. Trust me, I will be giving the movie credit where I see it due. I want to review this to settle a question in my mind. What is it that I truly disliked about this film? Is it just that it took a big fat shit on a real moment in history, or is there some fundamental problem with the movie itself? Is my disdain for the movie based on merit, or only on principle? The only way I know how to answer that question is just to review the movie. Just say how I feel every step of the way, and hopefully by the time I reach the epilogue, I will have my answer. So no more beating around the bush. Let's do this, and let's do it right. We start out in more or less present day with an excavation team poking around the Titanic gravesite. We know they're searching for something specific, but we don't know what yet. They stumble upon an old safe, and everyone goes apeshit until they realize there's nothing in it but a few papers and such. Still, it might not be entirely worthless, and so they clean them all up and participate in an on-camera interview which reaches the home of an old woman.
Of course, everyone knows the familiar stories of Titanic, you know, the nobility of the band playing to the very end and all that. But what I'm interested in are the untold stories.
So basically, all the fake ones. The old woman recognizes the drawing and after contacting the team is invited to come aboard their ship. Lord knows it's a lot easier to cart an old woman onto the boat via helicopter than it is for any of them to go see her. She claims to be the girl in the drawing, but everyone on board is a bit skeptical. Some of her story doesn't seem to be adding up. So as she prepares to tell them her amazing tale, they show her a simulation of what happened to the Titanic. Now, I will give the movie this. This is some damn good foreshadowing.
Okay, here we go. She hits the berg on the starboard side, right? She kind of bumps along, punching holes like Morse code, dit, 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 along the side, below the waterline. Then the forward compartments start to flood. Now, as the water level rises, it spills over the watertight bulkheads, which unfortunately don't go any higher than E-deck. So now as the bow goes down, the stern rises up, slow at first and faster until finally she's got her whole ass is sticking up in the air. And that's a big ass. We're talking 20, 30,000 tons, okay? And the hull's not designed to deal with that pressure. So what happens? She splits right down to the keel and the stern falls back level. Then as the bow sinks, it pulls the stern vertical and then finally detaches. Now the stern section just kind of bobs there like a cork for a couple of minutes, floods, and finally goes under about 2:20 a.m., 2 hours and 40 minutes after the collision.
Thank you for that fine forensic analysis, Mr. Bodine. Of course, the experience of it was somewhat different.
We're going to find out just how true that is, and it's one of the only moments in the film where it actually turns something on its head a bit. This is interesting because no Titanic movie before this one really explored the sinking of the ship in detail. They didn't really show what a nightmarish roller coaster this must have been. They all portrayed it as kind of like that summary: boat goes up, boat goes down, everybody dies. But when we finally see this in the end, it really does make that analysis look like a simplistic pile of crap. Another thing that works in this opening is the use of flashbacks. As Rose is shown the interior of the boat, we see flashes, sometimes only for a second, and it really gets us primed for seeing her story. Unfortunately, then we see her story. And here we have a perfect replica of the way the Titanic looked, right down to the last painstaking detail. And we also have a completely bullshit account of what actually happened on the ship. First, we meet Rose, who doesn't seem all that impressed with the thing.
It doesn't look any bigger than the Mauritania.
You could be blasé about some things, Rose, but not about Titanic. It's over 100 feet longer than Mauritania, and far more luxurious.
We don't get a good picture of who this woman is, really, and unfortunately we never will. But then we meet Jack, and we know exactly who this character is.
Jack, you are Pazzo, you bet everything we have.
When you got nothing to lose.
I really hope you like lines like that. You know, the ones that sound more like a spoken word character description than a real sentence someone would actually say. Because for the most part, that's all you're gonna get out of this character. He spends more time talking about what kind of character he is than actually being developed as a person. The next few minutes of the film are all about contrast, and it's done all moderately well. We're introduced to Rose by way of her being escorted onto the ship like royalty, and we're introduced to Jack by way of him winning the tickets in a game of chance and having to scramble to get there. We see the puny size of Jack's quarters as he's squeezed in with four other dudes, in contrast to Rose strutting around one whole area of the ship. A lot of this movie is going to feature class differences, and this was a fairly effective way of setting this up. But then we actually get into some of the characters. Or rather, not so. Let's start with Rose. She made the comment that the boat doesn't look that big, and we've seen that she has a love for art. And then at dinner, she has a few choice words during the conversation.
I wanted to convey sheer size. And size means stability, luxury, and above all, strength.
Do you know of Dr. Freud, Mr. Ismay? His ideas about the male preoccupation with size might be of particular interest to you.
So the whole time this movie has been on, what has Rose had to say or do? So far, only three things. She complained about the size of the boat, she talked about her paintings, and she made a dick joke. The problem is that shoehorned into all of these boring scenes are narrations like this.
It was the ship of dreams to everyone else. To me, it was a slave ship, taking me back to America in chains. Outwardly, I was everything a well-brought-up girl should be. Inside, I was screaming. I saw my whole life as if I'd already lived it. An endless parade of parties and cotillions, yachts and polo matches. Always the same narrow people, the same mindless chatter. I felt like I was standing at a great precipice. with no one to pull me back. No one who cared or even noticed.
You know, when you say that, it's all well and good, but this is the problem with the character Rose. She talks a good game about how she feels trapped and hates the life she's in, but the film never reinforces that character trait with any of the vital information necessary to make us care. James Cameron is setting a foundation for her with her feeling trapped in her own world, but he never builds anything on that foundation. There are 1,000 holes in this character that will never be filled in. She doesn't want to be in the aristocratic lifestyle anymore? Fine. But why? What does she want to be other than this? What dreams does Rose have that this world is holding her back from? These are pretty essential details we need to know in order to accept that she's gonna fling herself off a freaking boat, for God's sake. What makes Rose a tedious and boring character is that, again, these crucial holes will never be filled in, and thus the character simply remains blank. We need more information other than, I just don't want to be an aristocrat anymore, in order to care about this. And then, of course, we have Cal. The character Cal almost personifies what's wrong with this story, and it's not even that it's bad. It's that it's all completely by the numbers. As I've said before, a good remake or homage or retelling of a story should give those who aren't familiar with this stuff a reason to maybe want to check it out, and more importantly, it should give those of us who are familiar with this stuff something that we haven't seen before. And we don't get that with any aspect of this film, the story or the characters. But Cal in particular comes off as ridiculously out of place in this setting. He talks the part, but he is nothing more than a big walking movie cliche.
You know I don't like that, Rose.
She knows.
I don't use that.
Something Picasso. He won't amount to a thing. He won't, trust me.
Put the Degas in the bedroom.
At least they were cheap.
School? No wife of mine is going there. Shut up and make my babies. Snurd, flimschner.
See? I can do that too. People like this don't exist in the real world. We have jerks, but they aren't cartoonish movie jerks who only say and do things designed to make the audience hate them. This guy is right out of the movies, which would have been fine if this film wasn't rooted entirely in a real-life context. It's not so bad in the beginning when we only get a lot of trite dialogue out of him, but when we really start getting into the film and he starts acting like a retard in order to simply remain the villain, that's when things really start to fall apart with him. That's nothing against the performance, either. From an acting point of view, Billy Zane is doing a fine job with the material. It's the material that sucks. Or rather, it's the material that is hooked to a track and never diverts into anything interesting or unexpected. Which again would have been fine if it weren't for the sheer number of times this story has been told in this way. Given that everyone already knows this story, you would think James Cameron would at least have tried to put his own spin on it. Look at the Duke in Moulin Rouge, for example. The Duke was every bit as much of a cartoon as Cal. Actually, 100 times more so. Except that movie was rooted in a slightly cartoonish setting anyway, and you also had this exact same subject matter turned slightly on its side, which made all these routine villain tropes kind of interesting. You had that moment where the Duke is told to his face that he is the jerk of the story, who is designed to get his comeuppance, and he's like, wait a minute, I'm not the jerk! I'm offering Satine something real! Real stability and security. Christian's the jerk of this story. All he has to offer her is some whimsical idea of love. Christian is the real villain here. Why are you guys getting down on me? It was the exact same material as we have in Titanic and in many other stories, but seen from a slightly different perspective. The characters in that film all know the story they're in. They know what the rules are, and they each try to manipulate those rules. And that perspective allowed Moulin Rouge to do a story that has been told 1,000 times before in a way that people had never really seen before. That's not going to happen here. We have seen all this before in exactly this way, and that's all we get in this movie. Cal will never do anything more or less than what is expected of a villain in this story. He will overturn things, he will say mean words at them, he will shoot at them, and that's it. Trite, boring, who cares? But in the meantime, after only stating that she's sick of the lifestyle over and over again, Rose is about ready to throw herself off of the ship because she's bored, I guess. But soon Jack comes to the rescue. And again, a pretty good setup here as he describes the coldness of the water and what happens to you if you fall in. It's a conversation that will make the ending of this movie more terrifying as we now have a detailed description of what the poor souls in the water are going through. He saves her from falling over, but it all looks just a bit suspicious and he's put in cuffs. Fortunately, Rose manages to convince everyone that he simply rescued her, which convinces everyone but Cal's manservant.
You want to tie those? It's interesting that the young lady slipped so suddenly and you still had time to remove your jacket and your shoes.
I never really understood what he's suggesting here. Does he honestly think that someone is going to try and rape a girl on deck when there are a million officers around? Then again, they did let some girl fall off the back of a boat and only intervene when they heard her screaming, so maybe he's got a point. In any event, Jack is invited to dinner in the classy section of the boat. The next day, Jack and Rose have a little getting-to-know-you time, and once again, we get what is more akin to a character description than any actual person telling his story.
Well, I've been on my own since I was 15, since my folks died. And I had no brothers or sisters or close kin in that part of the country. So I lit on out of there, and I haven't been back since. You could just call me a tumbleweed blowing in the wind.
Wow, you just described like 20 play and storybook characters there. And if that wasn't bad enough, then Rose opens her mouth.
500 invitations have gone out. All of Philadelphia society will be there. And all the while I feel I'm standing in the middle of a crowded room screaming at the top of my lungs and no one even looks up.
See, this is what I'm talking about. We're only getting one half of a very important picture with this girl. So far, the only thing we know about her character is what she doesn't want. I'll give the movie this, though. As the banter between Jack and Rose continues, we do get a much improved scene over the ones we've seen between them so far. Instead of Jack just talking about how he's a walking character archetype and how Rose hates the life of the aristocrat for some reason, the two of them bond over a previously established story point. We do know that Rose loves art, and Jack is an artist. So as they bond over his craft, rather than saying trite lines at each other, it's a bit easier to care. The problem with Jack and Rose as a romantic interest, though, isn't even that the romance is bad. The problem is that you almost wish it was bad, just so you could at least feel something. So in case you haven't noticed by now, there is a common theme to each and every scene in this film so far. One, they're going on for too long, and two, they're all exactly the same. Jack and Rose meet up to go to the snooty party, and Jack is introduced to a few people who are actually aboard the Titanic. Of course, then, the speed tour that is this movie goes along, and we go back to more fake adventures with Jack and Rose. I guess when it comes to the real people on the ship, it was enough for Cameron that we only learned their names in passing. Anyway, when they all sit down to dinner, we get yet another scene of Jack simply explaining what kind of character he is and what's going on in the plot.
Tell us of the accommodations and steerage, Mr. Dawson. I hear they're quite good on this ship.
The best I've seen, ma'am. Hardly any rats.
My great uncle once saw a rat.
I mean, got everything I need right here with me. Got air in my lungs and a few blank sheets of paper. I mean, I love waking up in the morning not knowing what's gonna happen or who I'm gonna meet, or where I'm gonna wind up. Just the other night I was sleeping under a bridge and now here I am on the grandest ship in the world having champagne with you fine people.
Okay, I'm bored. But I will say this, I like how they didn't make everyone at the table follow the lines and just dismiss him out of hand.
You learn to take life as it comes at you. Go count. To make each day count.
Well said, Jack.
Yeah.
That guy actually kind of liked him. I like that. So anyway, the dinner is over, and the men are all ready to abandon the women and go smoke cigars and drink brandy together.
Joining us, Dawson? Well, you don't want to stay out here with the women, do you?
Stay out here with the women? Oh, of course not. I'd rather put a phallic-shaped object in my mouth than a room with a bunch of dudes. That wasn't a criticism of the film, by the way. I have never understood gentlemen's clubs. Never. Stick me in a room full of chicks any day. But I digress. After this, Jack takes Rose to a pauper's party, and she ends up having a genuinely good time. However, Cal is pissed off that she didn't obey him, and he overturns furniture and yells at her. Lather, rinse, repeat. And as if this wasn't all bad enough, Rose's mother then comes to have a few words with her, and here, right here, is one of the biggest barriers for interest in this film that we get. The mother explains that all of their family money is gone, and that continuing to fraternize with Jack is putting the family's legacy at risk. Now, this is obviously a pretty common plot element in a story like this, but from an audience point of view in this film, who cares? It's really hard to care about Rose as anything more than a caricature, and we sure as shit don't care about this old crone, so what is the consequence if Rose doesn't marry Cal, honestly?
Do you want to see me working as a seamstress? Is that what you want? To see our fine things sold at auction?
Yes, we do! And that's the problem. There just isn't anything creating conflict here, at least not as far as the audience is concerned. This is all very straightforward. We're supposed to want Jack and Rose together, and everyone else is to be thwarted. It's not like in Moulin Rouge, where if Christian and Satine get together, it's their friends that will suffer. These are all just stuffed shirt bad guys. Who cares if they don't get what they want? Anyway, Jack tries to see Rose once again, but the suits all feel that their debt has been paid to him and don't allow him to the fancy part of the ship anymore. So as Rose and the ship's designer talk in the background about something actually related to the story of the Titanic, Jack sneaks over and pulls Rose aside. Now, I've already talked a great deal about the problem of Jack's dialogue, and this scene is no different from what we've seen. Explain the character traits, explain the situation, lather, rinse, repeat. And I'm a little sick of repeating myself, so with nothing left to do, I'm just gonna sit here and go through the motions of the scene like I'm supposed to.
Jack, I'm engaged.
Uh-huh.
I'm marrying Cal.
Yep.
I love Cal.
All right.
I'm not an idiot.
Yeah.
I know how the world works.
Uh-huh.
I've got $10 in my pocket. I have nothing to offer you, and I know
that. That's true.
I understand.
Okay.
But I'm too involved now.
Right.
You jump, I jump, remember?
You jump, I jump. I want you to remember that, because... Anyway, so Rose tries to be a good little rich girl, but she can't get her mind off of Jack. So she goes to see him, and we have the famous I'm flying scene, and Jack draws her nude with a diamond on. And there really isn't much to say about the next 10 minutes or so of the film. They run around with each other and thwart the jerks, they kiss and fuck. It's all pretty routine. It's also completely external. We haven't had any reason to think that these two are really in love other than the fact that they keep saying they are, and now we're just watching them do love things. But again, that's not to say that their romance is bad. No, not even because it's all happening too fast or what have you. Beagle's rule applies and it's all fine. Again, it's just that it's all so perfectly routine. So Cal and his manservant are royally pissed off that Rose isn't doing what she's told, but then comes an iceberg headed straight for the ship. So that means that soon they're gonna have far bigger things to worry about than these two strutting around together, right? Right? I can at least say this, though. Even though it was a whopping hour and a half before we get to this, thank God for this next scene. Unlike Jack, Rose, and the two generic bad guys following them around all over the place, this all feels natural and period-specific. It feels like this is a real ship, with real people working on it that are making decisions in the moment. Their actions are frantic, but there are real procedures here that they fall back on. None of this Hollywood garbage of everyone reacting in a blind chaos. These officers proceed with a real professionalism.
Is there anyone there?
Yes, what do you see?
Iceberg, right ahead!
Thank you.
Iceberg, right ahead!
Turn to starboard!
Starboard!
This whole scene is damn good. It's so good, in fact, that it really makes me feel sad about what this movie could have been if Cameron had actually made it about what the title says it's about. He's focusing on all the wrong things. The detail of the ship so far has been immaculate. It all looks authentic and superb, possibly the most masterful recreation of a setting ever made in a period piece. But who cares what the ship looks like? It's what happened on this ship that matters. When we're shown the things and events that actually have to do with the Titanic, it's all done very well. But then comes Jack and Rose again to take us out of the experience completely. At least some good came out of this movie, though. I mean, I can at least say at this point that it wasn't completely worthless garbage. In the sadly brief moments like these, you might actually think you're watching a movie about the Titanic.
From this moment, no matter what we do, Titanic will founder.
But this ship can't sink.
She's made of iron, sir. I assure you, she can. And she will. It is a mathematical certainty.
How much time?
An hour, two at most.
And how many aboard, Mr. Murdoch?
2,200 souls on board, sir.
Well, I believe you may get your headlines, Mr. Ismay.
So here's the pattern of events from this point on. Everything that really happened on the ship is talked about in passing in the background, and in the foreground, boring, trite story elements that simply follow the lines. But what pisses me off about this is how callously James Cameron shirks the importance of what really happened.
She's all buckled in the forward hull.
Can you shore up?
Not unless the pumps get ahead.
Have you seen the damage in the mail hold?
No, she's already underwater.
Yeah, everyone in the mail room died staying at their posts even when the room was flooded, by the way, but of course Cameron won't tell you that. What he will tell you is something about a frame-up job on Jack. Who cares at this point? The boat is sinking! But what's interesting here is that after this point, we start to get kind of the best and worst of both worlds. The precious little that we see of the real Titanic story is done fairly well, but when it comes to the Romeo and Juliet story, everything goes very bullshit, very fast. More boring lines and scenes that we've already seen and heard so far. Cal gets pissed off and gives Rose a movie smack across the face. And then even when they're told that there's an emergency, Cal continues to read his villain cue cards and behave like a stereotype.
The goddamned English doing everything by the book.
There's no need for language, Mr. Hopley.
Sure there is. I'm the villain. How else do you know I'm supposed to be the jerk? Fuck. Shit. The English suck. The women suck. Money, power, winning. Those are the things I care about. Snurd.
Give me a fucking break. So after the frame-up job, Jack is handcuffed into the lower decks where the manservant takes him, and fuck me. James, do you not realize that you are taking one of humanity's most sobering personal tragedies and using it as a James Bond-style villain's trap?
Do you expect me to talk?
No, Mr. Bond, I expect you to die.
You know, I do believe this ship may sink.
Why are you not the least bit concerned about the sinking of the ship? Where you are? Right now? I mean, he just sits there like, oh good, now I can make this guy die. You know, maybe the fact that you're dying, that you're all dying, is a little more important than the fact that these two flipped you off, don't you think? No, of course you don't think. You're just the villain in a generic plot. Eventually, they're all told that the ship is going to sink, and Rose and her family try to get off the boat, and it's from this point on that the movie really starts to piss me off. Let me be clear before I continue. I understand that this isn't a documentary account of the Titanic. It's fictionalized. But that's the problem. They're fictionalizing this in a way that runs contrary to the importance of the real events. The story of Titanic was a story of bravery, selflessness, and heroism for the most part. But what pisses me off is that from this point on, all we see in this movie is an ugly face put on it. We see nothing but selfish behavior, every man for himself. This is a slap in the face to what actually happened just for the sake of trying to create a conflict in a fictional plot.
You know, it's a pity I didn't keep that drawing. It'll be worth a lot more by morning.
Will the lifeboats be seated according to class? I hope they're not too crowded. Oh, Mother. Shut up! Don't you understand? The water is freezing and there aren't enough boats. Not enough by half. Half the people on this ship are going to die.
Not the better half.
But wait, it gets worse. Rose eventually thwarts the jerk and runs down to the lower decks to look for Jack. She gets herself a bit lost and then is found by a gentleman who was walking around down there.
There's no need to panic!
No, I'm not panicking! You're going the wrong way! Listen!
The hell with you!
You know, there were people on that ship giving up their seats on the lifeboats, and those brave people died, saving strangers whom they had never even met. We don't see that in this movie. We see a man telling a panicked woman, "To hell with you." She eventually rescues Jack, and the two make their way back up to the ship, and it turns out that Cal has been busy making deals. This is not only remarkably stupid, it's also a monumental insult to the man being portrayed here. It's stupid because the officers on deck are all aware that there aren't enough boats. Their job is to get as many people off the ship and into the boats as they can, which means that Cal is bribing a man who he has to know is more than likely going to die anyway. And even if he doesn't know that, you have to factor in that Cal isn't the only wealthy person on the ship, and if he's cartoonishly bribing people for a seat, it means a bunch of other people are cartoonishly bribing people for a seat. And when you factor in all the panic and confusion on deck, this is just no guarantee. You're still in danger. But most importantly, this is an insult to the memory of the man being portrayed, because William Murdoch, yes, that was a real person with a real story on the ship, was one of the more prominent heroes on that voyage. He did everything in his power to get as many people off as he could calmly into the boats, and was lost at sea because of it. The suggestion that William Murdoch took bribes, shot people, and then killed himself is such a disgrace to the man's memory and legacy. I just can't wrap my mind around it. The makers of this film actually had to apologize to the entire town Murdoch was from for basically defaming him in front of billions of people. In my opinion, they should have apologized to the families of everyone on that ship.
Just go back to the main stairwell, and everything will be sorted out there. It will all get sorted out back there. Go back to the main stairwell.
Open the gate.
Go back down the main stairwell.
Open the gate right now.
Go back down the main stairwell like I told you.
There is no historical indication that the third-class passengers were ever forbidden from going up to the boats. In fact, it didn't even occur to anyone to try and get off the boat until towards the end, because they all believed that the ship could not sink. There were grills separating the third from first class passengers, but that was only to prevent access to certain first class sections of the ship, kind of like that blanket that separates first class in an airplane. A lot of the third class passengers did die, and some were locked in, but that was because the officers didn't have time to unlock all of the separation grills. It wasn't because they locked them down there and told them to fuck off and die. In fact, the biggest problem the third-class passengers faced down there was actually navigating their way up. A lot of them didn't even speak or read English, and there were far fewer stewards to guide people in the third-class sections than there were in the first. This was a failing on the part of the RMS Titanic to efficiently evacuate all the passengers, but the point is this. They just made this up to make everyone in the first class a dick and everyone in the third class a victim of the dicks. This movie is an idiot. But Jack and Rose get back to the top, and Cal insists that she get on the boat, telling her that there is another boat waiting for Jack. But of course, Rose dives out of the lifeboat and returns to Jack.
You're so stupid! Why'd you do that, huh? You're so stupid, Rose! Why did you do that? Why?
You jump, I jump, right?
Yeah, we'll see. Alright, so these two clearly intend to be together, and trying to separate them is really just hampering Cal's chances of survival, especially since everyone is now waist-deep in water and most parts of the ship. But that doesn't matter, because he could just leave them down there to die in the ship and start from scratch, and there's a seat where Rose was, waiting for him, and... Oh, yeah, right, he's gonna start shooting at them. Because, you know, there's nothing more important going on right now than these two being together.
Except the boat is sinking!
I'll tell you this much, I don't care how much of a bastard I was or how much money I threw in this guy's face, with all the panic and confusion going on deck at this point, I wouldn't waste a second of my time on these two idiots. I'd just find myself another trophy wife when I got back to port sipping a margarita. This movie is an idiot. So from this point on, we are merely shown the sinking of the ship. And I guess a few of the scenes could have been moving if this movie had been about anything other than Jack and Rose. To be fair, we do see the brave officers who tried to return in the lifeboats in the end, and we get a glimpse of Molly Brown taking charge and things like that, but it's just a little too little and a little too late at this point. This is just such a case of missing the point on Cameron's part. He seems to think that the only important part of the Titanic story is that it sunk. And I'll give him this, this was a very well executed, very real and terrifying portrayal of that ship going down. But he just fucked the story up so much and plastered a much less interesting one over it that this is all such a passive experience now. I mean, yeah, it sunk. But is that really all this movie had to offer us? Just having us watch the ship go down? But check this out. Jack and Rose go down together, no pun intended, and eventually find each other in all the confusion. Jack sets her on a board where there is clearly room for two people, but he can't quite set himself on it without disturbing Her Highness over there, so he just stays in the water. And what does Rose do about her dying boyfriend? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. She just stays on the plank of wood and lets him die. Lord knows they can't take turns on the plank of wood or maybe look for another plank of wood for him. No, she doesn't even try. And I know she's cold and dying, but so is Jack, for fuck's sake. You jump, I jump. That turned out to be the most literal thing ever said, because after the jumping, apparently all bets were off. Nothing says I love you like I'm cold and tired, so I'm just gonna lay here while you drown. So eventually Rose gets rescued and skirts Cal, who also made it off the ship, and then we jump back to present day. See, the people questioning Rose here have been looking for the diamond that she wore around her neck in the picture, and it turns out that the old woman had it with her all along, and... So, wait, she went all the way over there just to not give him the thing? Why the hell did she even bother to make the trip? This is no small thing. That seemed like a pretty risky flight for a woman her age. She was brought down in a wheelchair and brought all her shit over there just to throw the thing in the damn ocean? I don't get it. But you know what? If that had been the very, very end of the movie, I would have been forced to end this review on a bad note. But thanks to one last little scene, I can actually end this saying something nice. The scene at the end where the old lady dies and Jack and Rose find each other in the Never Never or wherever they are, and they embrace each other while everybody cheers, that scene worked. It fucking worked. I didn't give two flying shits about these two through the whole movie, and even I got a little choked up at that. Credit where credit is due, that was very well done. Unfortunately, I just can't say that about much else having to do with this movie. When it focused on the Titanic, it was more or less good. The rest was just an idiot. But I'll go into a lot more as to why I think that in the epilogue. John Simon once said in a negative review of Star Wars, and I know you guys are like, what, Matthew? John Simon? Star Wars? But trust me, I am going somewhere with this. John Simon once said in a negative review of Star Wars this: strip Star Wars of its often striking images and its scientific jargon, and you get a story, characters, and dialogue of overwhelming banality. I thought about that line of criticism a lot when considering this film, because when applying the same test to Titanic, it brings something to light that is far worse and far more amazing to me than what was said of Star Wars. Strip Titanic of the name Titanic. Set this on any other boat in any other place and time in history. Keep the same characters. Keep the same effects. Keep the exact same story. Just don't call this Titanic. And you get exactly what Simon described, a story, characters, and dialogue of overwhelming banality. You also get a movie that no one would ever have bothered to remember. Only because this movie bears the name Titanic did anyone bother with this. And since it's not even about what the title says it's about, it turns a movie that would have simply been a snooze fest into something of a remarkable insult. It uses a real tragedy to get a trite love story out there into the theaters to make money. Titanic is like those little fish that attach themselves to the bigger fish and suck off of them their whole lives. I asked myself before going into this review whether I thought this movie was bad based on the fact that it just repackaged a version of the story done a million times already, or whether I thought it was bad based on the fact that it pees all over a real historical event. And it turns out that the answer is both. Equally. This was a pretty bad movie on its own, but coupled with the fact that it shits all over history, it becomes nearly abominable. Let's start with the historical part, and then go from there. Now, to be fair, James Cameron never pretended that this was going to be a historical look at the Titanic. He did not mislead people. He had planned from the beginning to fictionalize these events. The problem is, that's a bad idea. Who thinks about a tragedy and says, we're gonna have it going on passively in the background while I go do my own thing with it for 2 hours? Who wants to take a real moment in history and fictionalize it for no other reason than for the audience's entertainment? Now, I know some of you might be saying, well, okay, but where's the harm, Matthew? People know this wasn't the real story of the Titanic. They know the information is out there about what really happened. They just like this fictionalized version of it. How is it hurting anyone? Well, I'll tell you how it's hurting people. It's hurting people because, for reasons I can't fathom, this movie is so damned huge that it has completely overshadowed the real story in our culture today. And as a result, I'm sorry to put it like this movie makes people stupid. I'm not saying you're stupid if you like this movie. Let me repeat that. I'm not saying you're stupid if you like this movie. I'm saying this movie literally breeds nothing but ignorance among people who will never know any better and only know what they see from this movie being constantly played and referenced everywhere. James Cameron's Titanic actually became a bigger and more well-known phenomenon than the real story of the Titanic. That's a problem. What does anyone even think about anymore when they hear the word Titanic? Do they think about the real human tragedy? Do they think about the real human cost? No, they think about that stupid, trite love story. The RMS Titanic, the real ship, not the stupid movie, recently had its 100-year anniversary of its demise, and they tried to commemorate the event on the talk. Now, once again, we're talking about the anniversary of the real ship, with the real people on it. So I'm sure the commemoration will be handled with dignity and respect for those who gave their life. Oh, for fuck's sake! It's a movie! It didn't happen, you fucking loons! It's just a movie! Those were real people who really gave their lives on that ship, and their memory and their legacy deserve a lot better than Celine Dion playing on the talk! You make me sick! When you think of the story of the Titanic, the last thing that should ever go through your mind is romance. But thanks to the baffling success of this movie, that's all anyone associates with it anymore. And that brings us all down at least one collective IQ point in our society. I mean, you could do this with anything. Take the exact plot and set it anywhere in any tragedy. Chernobyl, the Hindenburg, Hiroshima, Pearl Harbor. Oh wait, they actually did that. And why do you think that is? Why do you think they thought they could get away with this? Because James Cameron got away with it. And just imagine if in 100 years from now, they make this exact same movie set in the World Trade Center. Just imagine what a terrible insult that would be. Now, at times in this review, I had compared Titanic, which I hate, to Moulin Rouge, which I love, because both films have the exact same core plot. But people have been asking me for years why I had a problem with Titanic not being about the real Titanic, but I had no problem with Moulin Rouge not being about the real Moulin Rouge. That is a perfectly legitimate question, and I hope my answer will at least make sense to you. After becoming an admirer of the film, I did a little bit of research about the real Moulin Rouge, not extensively to be honest, but here's the thing. While the history of the real Moulin Rouge may be interesting, it's not particularly important. This is important. It's part of who we are. It's part of our collective human condition. It is a real-life parable about the hubris of humanity. Our collective dicks were so much bigger than our brains, we built a huge ship that didn't have enough lifeboats on it. And that only scratches the surface of what the Titanic story really teaches us. It teaches us about bravery, chivalry. It had nothing to do with class struggles and fucking in a car. Another reason Moulin Rouge doesn't bother me in this way is that the setting itself was fictionalized. No one is going to mistake the cartoonish events in that film for the real thing. It also wasn't so huge a phenomenon that it completely overshadows the real one and prevents any other story being told about it. If someone wants to make another movie that tells the story of the real Moulin Rouge, they can easily do so. No one will ever make another Titanic movie. Let me try to cover that base a little bit more, actually. At least not for another 80 years will anyone ever try to make another Titanic movie. What studio would take that risk? What writer would take that risk? It's the biggest movie in the world. No matter how real or how much better another Titanic film could be after this, there's just no topping that. So I think I've covered everything I can about that aspect of the film that bothers me, so let's move to the story itself. In this part, I will be comparing Titanic heavily with Moulin Rouge, but I want to stress from the beginning that I'm not arguing Moulin Rouge good, Titanic bad. I think that's true, but this isn't me pushing a movie I like onto others. Since both films have the exact same core plot, this comparison will help me to clarify why one worked for me and the other didn't. But I'm not an evangelist preaching the gospel of Moulin Rouge here. While I realize that this isn't the only reason people didn't like the film, one of the major issues people seem to have with Moulin Rouge was its frantic pace and jumping all over the place like a kid with too much sugar. The people who complain about that element of the film are not wrong, and I think that is a perfectly legitimate reason not to like the film if this isn't a style you prefer. I've never paid the least bit of attention to style, so it didn't affect me, but if you do, then I can absolutely see why you wouldn't want to watch a film like this. It's just like Blade Runner. As I've said before, Blade Runner is slow, and it is boring. And anyone who complains about it so is correct. I simply don't think its pace has any bearing on how good it was. Same with Moulin Rouge. I think in that way, Moulin Rouge is on the clear other end of that spectrum, and those who claim that it's hopped up on sugar and crack in its presentation are quite correct. Again, it simply has no bearing for me on how good it was. But I ask you to ignore that part of the film for the moment and simply focus on how it told its story in comparison to how Titanic told its story. In several reviews, Doug Walker criticized Moulin Rouge for many reasons, one of which was because, as he put it, it's Titanic. And he's right. But that's kind of the point, isn't it? I mean, Titanic wasn't even Titanic. James Cameron literally pitched this idea to studios as Romeo and Juliet on the Titanic. It bothers me when people say that Moulin Rouge is a ripoff of Titanic, not because Moulin Rouge is my favorite movie, but because that statement suggests that Titanic did anything original that anyone else could rip off. This again breeds more ignorance because people seem to be under the ridiculous impression that James Cameron was the first to do this. He wasn't even the best to do this, probably not even fifth best. What is the core plot of this film? You've got the nice girl from one class being forced and/or pressured to marry someone she doesn't want to marry, but falls for the nice guy of a different class. This is a plot that has been around since time immemorial. Even Shakespeare wasn't the first to do this. Virtually every modern-day Disney film has this plot. Gloria Stewart, who played the older Rose, was in a movie called Gold Diggers of 1935, which had this plot. La Boheme had more or less this plot. The Wedding Singer had the exact same plot as these two films. It doesn't matter to me in the slightest, however, because to me, it doesn't matter what the plot is, or who did it first, or how many times it's been done. The only thing that matters is what you, the writer, do with this plot. And James Cameron didn't do much. Moulin Rouge was downright celebrating this formula. It knew exactly what it was and played with that knowledge. By presenting the story with three different perspectives, two of which could interact with one another and the third that could not be changed, he conveyed this timeless formula in a new way. Moulin Rouge was almost about this very story, asking what would happen if the participants knew they were in it. It was a fantasy, and at the core it definitely followed the lines and did what it was supposed to do, but the artistry of telling the story is what made it shine. It also helped that Baz Luhrmann had a background in theater, and he brought that to the screen in a big way. Moulin Rouge was basically a Broadway production that Luhrmann just happened to shoot for the screen. This was a screenplay written by someone who clearly understood this stuff. He had experience with the origins of this story and lent his own craft to the retelling. James Cameron didn't really do that here. He just did Romeo and Juliet again. Only he plunked it down on the Titanic. This story just goes through the motions, leading to nothing new or interesting. Without adding a single original concept to this movie, the material almost literally wrote itself. I had said in the review that James Cameron doesn't seem to understand the importance of the Titanic story over and above the fact that it sunk. He had the same lack of understanding when it comes to this formula as well. Baz Luhrmann is a writer who really understood this stuff and brought that understanding to the retelling of this tale, but James Cameron only seems to know the story on such a basic level. Couple meets, gets torn apart, comes back together, one or both dies, credits. That's all this movie is. Hell, even when Baz Luhrmann did Romeo and Juliet, he gave us a fresh perspective by having one side of the film be classic and the other side be modern. And God, that was a better movie. Which brings me back to my original question. What is so special about Titanic? It all goes in one tidy, straight line that we are all painfully aware of. We've been there before, and James Cameron is only taking us to the same old place. While Baz Luhrmann did something unique with this formula, James Cameron just did it again. And when I think of how monumentally huge this film became, I am honestly and truly confused. Look, I'm not trying to get down on you if you're a fan of Titanic. If you love this movie, great. I just honestly don't understand what the big hulking deal about it is. I mean, maybe if this is the only incarnation of this story you've ever seen in your life, I could understand it. Maybe. Or if you only had Romeo and Juliet to compare. Otherwise, I'm stumped. So, let's ask one final question here. Is this a bad movie? Yeah, it kind of is. But this time, it's not because it was written badly. It's because they didn't even try. I would rather have a writer try and fail miserably than have a writer not try at all and succeed the way this movie did. To say that a movie is overrated really doesn't mean much, especially coming from me. It's not a judgment of the film as much as it is a judgment of how the film was received, and every movie that I review as Confused Matthew I think is overrated anyway. But as a parting word, I just have to say it, even knowing the consequences. Titanic is the most overrated movie ever made.